water.
This is the toughest situation to deal with that I've seen now, short of Vietnam.
What was remaining of the upper story just fell in. It was leaning precariously for some time. Now it just fell into the street.
We just heard a sniper shot. No one knows where it has come from here at the corner of Taylor and 12.
There are rows of houses here on my right, at least four or five, all that's standing. The foundation and the chimneys, even the basements are afire.
Our community has been torn apart. We have spent years trying to build bridges, and then to have persons just come in and in a few hours to destroy this is a little bit more than some of us can take.
I'm Joe Perkins, and we're on 12th Street, renamed Rosa Parks Boulevard. This is Ground Zero for the tumultuous days that would forever change the landscape of Detroit. Now, what really happened here is still up for debate. Some call it a riot. Others say it was an uprising, a rebellion. Whatever you call it, we're not here to rewrite history. We're here to show you history, our history, from the TV2 archives, film from five decades ago.
Congressman, is there any relief in sight? How have you been handling this situation?
Well, I think that we can't overpraise the way that the local officials have handled this matter. I think that finally it's become painfully clear that we can't isolate the problems, that they are spreading indeed throughout the whole city.
Entire blocks have been leveled by fire and pockets of destruction exist throughout the city. Losses due to fire and looting have been estimated at hundreds of millions of dollars, and these estimates may well prove to be conservative.
This is 12th and Claremont, where it all started. Right now it's Thomas Gordon Park, but back then, this was a busy area filled with shops and entertainment. People had gathered here at an illegal after-hours nightclub that police called a blind pig. They had come here to celebrate the homecoming of two soldiers from the Vietnam War. Detroit police raided that bar, called in paddy wagons, and hauled off about 80 people to jail. That's when all hell broke loose. When it ended, 43 people were dead and more than 1,000 injured.
You see all this fire and all this stuff going on, you think it was a war going on.
In the middle of all the chaos, Tigers great Willie Horton felt compelled to come here to the corner of 12th and Claremont. The 67 Tigers were in the middle of the pennant race, and Horton, still in his Tigers uniform, jumped on top of a car to try to calm the crowd.
At the gate, they told we had to go home for our secure purpose, and you see all that black smoke. I saw what's going on. So the riot is burning down on 12th. And so I went in the clubhouse, and all the thing came to my mind is put my clothes in my duffel bag, and next day I know I was out there in the middle of the riot on 12th and Claremont trying to talk to the people, bring peace.
We've called up the full National Guard, and we should have by tomorrow morning about 6,000 to 7,000 National Guardsmen here, as well as the additional state police and, of course, the full Detroit Police Department. Now, I think
one of my teammates, Michelotis, is in the reserve. He was down there a couple of days later because we went to Baltimore, and he had to stay here because he was in the reserve.
The Detroit Tigers are making that push for the American League pennant, and they're after the Chicago White Sox this weekend. But they're without the services of pitcher Mickey Lolich. He's here guarding the city of Detroit. Mickey, when did you get the word?
Well, I got the word Tuesday about noon. I had my suitcase on the bus. I was ready to leave for Baltimore, and they informed me that they were looking for Wayne Redmond. In return, I called out at the base, and they said, yes, I was supposed to report, so I took my suitcase off the bus and I waved the mail and I started heading out of the parking lot, and he says, well, who's going to pitch in Chicago? I says, I don't know. You have to find somebody else. Sure hope they're going to get in there. I sort of feel lost not being with them right now. I had spent some time during the service during summer camp and been spending more time in a green uniform than I have a white one lately.
When do you think you'll be able to join? Any idea?
Well, I think we'll have to talk to General Throckmorton about that one. I don't have the slightest idea.
It's extremely difficult for our law enforcement officers, the state, the National Guard, and our local police to enforce the law and maintain the degree of law and order that we all expect. And unless we have the cooperation of the people of this city, it's just not going to be done. They're the most important ingredient at this point, and that's why it's so important that they do this.
Don't you know the big D is burning?
This is a scene that's being repeated so many times in Detroit, it's hardly news anymore, and yet it's the story of the city of Detroit, and it's our...
Do you know at all why these fires were set? Do you have any idea?
Why have ideas? Oh, I don't know why the... I mean, how they started, why?
Why the fires were set in the city?
Well, in my opinion, it just led from frustration, you know, to me. Frustration to try to get things that I didn't add to you.
I don't know what it's all about.
This is now a vacant lot that the city is trying to turn into a park, but 50 years ago, from Pingree all the way to Blaine, this was a neighborhood filled with houses after houses, filled with families who lived and worked and played here. But in July of 67, it all went up in smoke. Hello, ma'am.
I was right in it.
You were right in it?
Yeah. And sure enough, it was fire. It was people that was angry. It was terrible. My car burned up in the front, and we kept water. We had to wash the porch down with keeping the hose on the, you know, porch fell in. It was terrible. The fire department couldn't come in, and there was nothing nobody could really do. But just keep our hoses on this house to keep them from burning.
Long after the smoke clears away and life returns to normal here in Detroit, the families that lived in these burned-out homes and the hundreds of apartments that were destroyed by the arsonist firebombs will be battling with insurance companies. And it's still feared that some of the insurance companies may use the insurrection clause as a reason for not paying the claims.
They didn't give one dime to what was happening here at this house.
So you got no...
No insurance for my car. I had car and house insurance both. On the same company. They offered me $140.
Project Rebuild, the mayor's committee, which is going to try to do something for the 300 to 400 families that have lost their homes, among other plans, hope to bulldoze some of these burned-out buildings, lease the property from the existing owners, put on mobile homes. Most of the families, however, have been absorbed into the community and are temporarily living with other families.
Did you ever think of moving out?
No. I promise, my God, if I got here, I would not go anyplace.
One thing is for sure, that everybody in Detroit, in the riot area or not, are going to be affected by the damage.
All you knew that back then was you got to protect your house.
That's right. I've tried to protect my house, and that's what I was trying to do.
The claims and the heavy damage may cause people in Detroit to pay a whale of a price for future insurance. This is Joe Weaver on Pingree near Linwood.
Approach the area with your lights out. Approach the area with your lights out.
In this darkness, one never knows what's lurking in the shadows of these, especially the side streets leading off of 12th Street. There's continued sniper fire down here from Herman Kiefer. We can hear it every so often. Pow, pow, pow. A few shots will ring out. There's also been continued harassment of the fire department as they've tried to fight some fires in this area.
As governor of the state of Michigan, I do hereby officially recommend the immediate deployment of federal troops into Michigan to assist state and local authorities in reestablishing law in the state of Detroit. I am joined in this recommendation by Jerome P. Cavanaugh, mayor of the city of Detroit. This recommendation follows a period of 4 hours in which uncontrollable arson, looting, and threat to human life by snipers, as well as in the cities of Hamtramck and Highland Park.
The first contingents of the 5,000 troops started to arrive at Selfridge Air Force Base about 3:45.
About 6.5 hours after Governor Romney requested them in a telegram to President Johnson. They consist of the 2nd Brigade of the 101st from Fort Campbell, Kentucky, and the 3rd Brigade of the 82nd Airborne from Fort Bragg, North Carolina.
Let's go, buddy. Get out of the way. Let's go.
We just heard a sniper shot. No one knows where it has come from here at the corner of Taylor and 12th. Police are down the street a half a block searching some suspects. The residents here are dazed. They don't know which way to go to get away from the National Guardsmen and the direction of the shot, because nobody knows where it has come from. Just down the street, not too many blocks away from where they have the sniper pinned down, police uncovered three bodies in the basement of a packaged liquor store. They surmised that these three bodies, which were being taken out at this moment, were those of looters that were trapped downstairs when the burning floor fell in on top of them.
The state troopers and the National Guard units have been inadequate, and I think that the request to the President of the United States for a federal presence is timely and appropriate and is necessary.
This rumbling noise you hear here is coming from two tanks which are parked on 12th at the boulevard. These tanks are moving out now, rumbling down 12th at the boulevard. They're crossing the boulevard right now. This is the big push they've been talking about all night. At first they gave up. They gave this area over to the snipers. More or less said it's sniper territory and let them have it. Wait a minute. We're pulling up now at 14th and Davis, and they've got a searchlight up on the third floor of a brick building on the south side of Davis, and the tanks have both pulled up and stopped, and they've got their machine guns pointed that way. Sure, here.
That was at 3 o'clock in the morning. It's 7:30 now, and somehow it's a completely different scene. It's not a sinister-looking building anymore. It's an apartment house where a lot of innocent people were living. Mr. and Mrs. James Porter live in the apartment house. Mr. Porter, what was it like?
It was terrible. It was just like a blasting fire, you know, and bullets shaking, ricocheting all over the area.
Did you hear any shots come from this building before they started?
Yes, it sounded like we were in Vietnam or something. All this excitement, and boy, I was panicked, and I told my husband about it, and then he says, get on that floor, and I ran on the floor.
Although hundreds of rounds were fired into this building, fortunately, no one was injured. This is Jack McCarthy reporting from the 2200 block of West Davison.
In 67, when the stuff jumped off, when I say the stuff, the rebellion, the riot, the revolution, the civil disturbance, whatever your terminology is, the uprising, I remember that day.
This place has significance for you.
This is where I started, basically in Detroit. You standing now at 2683 Buena Vista.
It's all foliage now, but back in the day, it was on and popping.
It was a neighborhood. Now it looks like somebody just came through here and just tore it up. But people lived here, good people. The troops were coming down this street. And I stood in my window and I was looking outside to see what was going on. And I'll never forget, this federal trooper took his long gun. I thought it was a big, maybe because I was small and short, or maybe because the gun was long and taller, I don't know. But it seemed like a long gun. He took his long gun and he pointed it at me. Just, I thought he was getting ready to shoot me. And I jumped the hell out the window.
When you look back, though, at a 17-year-old Wendell Anthony, and you look back at the night you knew that the Motor City was on fire.
Yeah.
Was there anger? Was there fear? Was there both?
It was both. It was anger. It was fear. It was frustration. It was intimidation. It was like, what the hell are we going to do?
What did you say in your sermon today after what's happened in Detroit?
Well, my sermon was on faith because the president has called for us to have a day of prayer, and I feel that we must have faith, interpreted faith with works. This means that we must involve ourselves more in politics, because it's going to be a political decision as to who runs this town. If the lawless element is going to run the town, or if the element that believes in law and order is going to run the town, it'll be a matter of people making political decisions.
50 years ago, the number one issue was the police department and the fact that black people did not feel as though they were respecting, and they weren't. There were no blacks of any significant number on the police department, fire department. We only had one black on the common council at the time. That was Nick Hood.
What do you see for the future of Detroit? The immediate future, perhaps? What is your opinion on that?
Well, I just see a lot of hard work of trying to bring all of the various diverse elements of our community together.
Even after 50 years, what are we going to do about it? Now, admittedly, things are different. You've had five black mayors. You got a black prosecutor, you got a black Wayne County executive, you got a black police chief, you got an integrated police department, you got an integrated fire department, you got black commissioners, you got seven black folk on the city council, you got Hugh Perkins on Fox News. We didn't have all that back then.
Firemen here ahead of us, working desperately, trying to keep two homes here from completely going down, but of course they're not going to be able to do it. They're going to burn to the ground.
I've heard before that frustration leads to aggression, and it's what has happened.
Do you think it can ever happen again in Detroit?
Well, I do. I really do.
Holler when you're ready.
Okay.
All right. Yeah. Take some with you.
When you have nothing, you can't lose anything.
If you don't want to have a repeat of 67, what do? We learn from history. This don't take no PhD. Jobs, economic opportunity, educational system. We want the same thing that everybody else wants. We want the same thing. It's not no different here. And so I'm simply saying, I don't know why we complicate this.
What happened here 50 years ago was dubbed the 12th Street Riots. But was it a riot? A rebellion, an uprising. It's far from black and white.
It represents a racial rebellion that goes from coast to coast. In the city of Detroit, it represents one simple thing. Black people want control of black communities.
As I saw the kind of people being brought into the police stations last night, they're the black have-nots of this country, who have stored up more resentment than I or anybody else thought that they could store up. And it's coming out, and it's ugly.
There's no question it was a rebellion. The fact being that a rebellion is an act or actions against things that you've been repressed, suppressed against for years and years. And people tend to think that this is as 1967. This started long before 1967.
I call it a riot. I definitely call it a riot. And I lived at 12th and Woodrow Wilson in Boston. It was like one block over and three short blocks down. So it was right there. There were National Guardsmen at our door. You could see the fire, you could smell the smoke, you could hear the clashes. It was terrible. Same thing at night. You could hear bullets and hear shots all the time. We slept on the floor because you don't want somebody to shoot through the window. And so later on, you go riding around and looking and say, God, dog, look at this stuff. I mean, windows and cars and houses and trash, and it looked like somebody had dropped a bomb. I looked like we were in bombed out Beirut. It was unbelievable. It was a riot, Huel. It was a riot.
About 1,700 businesses were targeted. Black shop owners would put signs in their windows that read, "Soul Brother," in hopes of being spared.
A Negro shop owner, why were you looted?
Well, with any group, any mob, you're going to find people who are, they don't care about race, they don't care about color, they don't care about religion, anything. They just want to get something for nothing.
I hope that the impression that the whole Negro community is not involved in this gets through. Actually, it's a small percentage of people.
It was three young white boys who said it.
Did you see them around here before? Did they live around
here?
No,
I didn't see them. They don't live around here.
Do you see any sense to this?
No, none at all. Because the people had taken everything out of the stores. There was nothing left. Now, why should they set the places on fire after everything's gone out of the places? This is senseless.
Do you see any racial overtones to this at all?
No, I don't, because I can see just as many white as I can see colored taking things out of the stores.
The overwhelming majority of the Negro community is stunned, shocked, and dismayed by the lawlessness of a very small percentage of people and youngsters that have brought this holocaust upon this city.
This distrust of police has been going on for a long time. It was a normal thing for them to stop young black men, to throw them up against a building or against a car, and beat them up. And just so happens that in 1957, my first year of high school, I became a victim. And in fact, it was my first year at Cass Tech. As I was walking across the street, this car was called the Big Four, with four very large white officers, grabbed me, threw me up against the car, and proceeded to beat me, curse me, racial epithets. I mean, it was just beyond one's imagination. The officers told me to get my black ass out of there. I ran home, but I made myself a promise that evening that I was going to become a police officer.
When you looked at 67 living through that, then, yes, there was a sense of rebellion, but was that not also a sense of fear?
I was shot at by the police, my fellow officers, and the reason being that I was a black person.
You were on the force at the time?
Yeah, I was on the police department. I'd been just short of 1 month, and I was stopped over on Chicago by the freeway. And these officers got out of their car. I was in uniform. They got out of their car, and the name calling, and told me I was going to die that night, and shot at me. The good thing about that time is I was young and agile, and I dove into my car, which is a 1965 Mustang, and sped off with my hand on the accelerator, my other hand on the steering wheel as I sped off. But they were shooting at me. Now, you're shocked, but you say to yourself, you know, if they're doing this to me, a fellow officer, what are they going to do to other people in this city? And the proof is in the pudding, in that there were 43 people killed during the 1967 rebellion.
The casualties from this conflict have been arriving all night long here at Detroit General Hospital in the heart of the city. Talking to one doctor at 4 a.m. in the morning, he said, "It's just beginning." In the last 10 minutes, three dead bodies have been wheeled down this corridor and into these rooms. Countless others are being wheeled into emergency rooms where doctors are working feverishly on their cases, most of them serious. Attendants here say since the rioting broke out, they've handled approximately 475 cases, and they say they really can't keep an accurate count. They claim that they have at least 23 to 25 deaths handled just here at Detroit General Hospital. Attendants here say tonight's cases are more serious than last night, when most of those treated were for lacerations and burns. Tonight, most of the casualties are from gunshot wounds. This is Jerry Hodak reporting from Detroit General Hospital.
Days of violence and looting saw 7,000 people arrested and shuffled through an overburdened justice system.
As prosecuting attorney of this county and as chief law enforcement officer in this county, I want to assure all the citizens that those people who are committing crimes during this time of disorder are being arrested and they are being prosecuted to the fullest extent of the law.
Today, Tuesday, Wayne County Jail is full. It is full to capacity and prisoners are being moved to Jackson State Prison.
And I want to warn all those people who might be thinking of looting or stealing or burning, that we're not to fool themselves, because we're going to prosecute them.
We're watching the transfer of prisoners from Wayne County Jail, which is seriously overcrowded. These men are boarding chartered DSR buses for a ride, we're told, to Jackson Prison.
50 years ago, Detroit was the fifth largest city in the country with 1.5 million residents. Today, Detroit doesn't even break the top 20 with fewer than 700,000. Back then, black people made up 40% of the population. Now, car plants and businesses were starting to move out to the suburbs long before the summer of 67, and those who could afford it, mostly white, followed. But after those 5 days in July, what started as a stream of white flight became a raging river.
What's the matter with you?
You see, the fires like this, it's not just the burning of the building, it's a tragedy of people being displaced from their homes. At least two elderly ladies lived upstairs in that apartment's over the fire, and now two doors down, here is a family starting to evacuate. Did you live upstairs here,
yeah,
sir?
Uh-huh.
Is it getting pretty hot up there?
Yes, it is.
How many people in your family?
Five.
All of them children?
Three of them children.
Do you have any place to go?
No, I don't.
What are you going to do?
Go out and away from afar till I find some place. I don't know.
There are no white solutions. There are no black solutions. There are no Democratic solutions, and there are no Republican solutions. There are only American solutions that deal with the problems of all the people, and we need to work on that basis if we are to strengthen the basic unity of this community.
The summer of 67 didn't change the world, but it did change Detroit. In the middle of the racial divide, the death and the damage, Detroiters stepped up to help each other as they had never done before. Everyday people like teachers, cab drivers, housewives, students, risked their own lives to protect complete strangers from the violence, the gunfire. They provided food to the paramedics, firefighters, and the many who were left homeless. Despite the anger and the fear, there were people, black and white, who reached out to each other in faith and in hope. Out of the ashes grew a determination to prevent this from ever happening again. Yes, problems remain, but the lesson from 67 is that we can solve them if we work together. Thank you for watching.